Okay, let's take the rest of the discussion offline. And our last speaker for today is Anand Sarwate, and he is from TTI Chicago, and he'll be telling us about stochastic gradient descent with differential privacy.
Right, and this is work with Monica. I'm sorry, I'm coming down with something, so and also I'm standing between you and wine, so I'll try to go actually extra fast here. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about today is stochastic gradient descent and obviously differential privacy. So what's going on here? So why do people like stochastic gradient descent or these stochastic optimization methods? It's because if you have a lot of data, then doing standard the computation of gradients is challenging because it's hard to fit all the data in a single machine, or maybe your data is coming in online in a streaming setting and the delay may and the data also might come with constraints such as privacy, but also there's this computational challenge where like you just can't run the standard algorithm because you have too much data. So the problem we're going to consider is just a convex minimization problem. So I want to minimize some function. I have n data points, z1 through zn. I guess maybe we should have had some notation standardization at the beginning of the workshop. Probably I'm going to do something completely different than everyone else. So what we want to do is minimize sum of some loss function over the data points. So w is the parameter I'm optimizing over. I want to find the best w, say a d-dimensional vector, that minimizes some loss over the data. And so if I wanted to minimize this directly, essentially I'd have to, and I would do, say, gradient descent. I'd have to compute n gradients, one for each loss function, which is like taking one full scan over the data, which is like not possible in a lot of cases. So as a concrete example, I'm just going to look at logistic regression because I like logistic regression. And in this case, the data is just labeled pairs. So the xi is a vector, d-dimensional vector, and yi is a label, plus minus one label, indicating, you know, xi is the data of test values and y is whether or not the person has a disease. And what I'll do is minimize this regularized logistic, I'll replace this loss function by this logistic loss, which is just a way of weighting how wrong my predictor wt is on this, on this xt, right, thank you. And then there's this regularization to prevent overfitting, right? So this is like standard machine learning stuff. Okay, so in particular, for those who are not familiar, because I know there's some non sort of computer scientists, engineering types here, basically what we're trying to find is a hyperplane. W defines a hyperplane which separates my data into two classes, plus one and minus one, right? So we often solve this problem using gradient descent, but when n is very large, we have to compute n gradients, as I said before, and it's pretty hairy. So what do people do? People do what's called stochastic gradient descent. So what I do is I have my n data points, and I just pick one of them at random, and I do a gradient step with respect to that one data point. So that's, and I just operate iteratively. So this is my estimate of the minimizer w star is at time t plus one, oops, is forgot a boldface, is equal to my old estimate minus a gradient step. This is the gradient of the previous objective function just evaluated at the one point, and you have the regularization there with the lambda. And this eta t is this constant multiplicative factor outside. This is called the learning rate sometimes, or in step size, and we often set it to something like 1 over t, or constant over t, or constant over root t. Those are pretty standard choices. And so some things to note about this is that the expected gradient, if I took I'm taking a random data point at each time, the expected gradient is a true gradient. So this is really just a stochastic approximation to the standard gradient descent algorithm. And so you can do your Robbins-Monroe type thing. In practice, though, what people do is actually sample without replacement. So you just do a scan through the data, you know, just process each data at one point at a time. But the theoretical guarantees are usually for the sampling model. Often, what you find in practice is that you take a few passes through the data, and then you're pretty much good as you would do as if you had processed all the data in full-on gradient descent. So these are kind of the things that you do in practice, right? And so what about privacy? Obviously, so if the data is private, then you know you have to think about the data actually as being kind of a limited resource, because every time I touch a data point, I'm going to pay an epsilon for my differential privacy. So now it's not like I can just scan through the data multiple times until I'm done. you have to think about how you're going to do that, right? And so now I'm balancing privacy and utility and somehow efficiency of my computational procedure. But maybe it's easy because essentially the stochastic gradient descent is already a randomized approximation to the regular gradient descent, so maybe I'm just adding some more noise and that's fine, right? Okay, so what do you do this for the gradient descent procedure? It's not, I mean, not, this is not news. You just add some noise to the gradient, right? So you now take a noisy gradient step and you kind of hope that the fact that this is a noisy approximation to the true gradient and this is some more noise, and what is the distribution of that noise? We're going to choose it Laplace-like, isotropic and Laplace distributed. And we're just going to add noise at every iteration. Okay, super. We'll be done before that. And this guarantees differential privacy in the continuous observation setting, which many people are probably familiar with, or more recently, this also satisfies in this local privacy model. So these are slightly different notions. The point being here that I can actually just publish the iterate as I go along, the whole path. And so this is like the continuous observation model. In the local privacy model, the idea is that I go to the data holder who holds the data Z, and I say, please compute for me a gradient. And they say, no, I'm going to give you this noisy gradient instead, and then you operate in that way. So this is the setting we're in. And so, okay, so why don't we just do it? What happens? Oh, not so great. So here I'm plotting, this is for a synthetic data set, it's like Gaussians. Oh, no, sorry, it's a uniform distribution on the sphere. And the standard algorithm converges, you can see it's like after 1,000 iterations, just without noise, it's like, I'm there, I'm done. This is the value of the objective function, whereas the differentially private algorithm not only has pretty large variance, it sort of takes a long time to get there. So you would have to have a pretty large data set if you're going to go a single scan through the data set to get close to what you would get without privacy.
Slow you down, you food waiting.
And wine.
What is the and wine? Yeah, it's even worse. What is the normalization of the data and what privacy guarantee are you shooting for?
Epsilon, not epsilon delta.
What is the
alpha. The normalization of the data. The unit. You're rescaled to
the data item is a unit vector.
Not every data item is a unit vector.
At most norm one.
Yeah, at most norm one. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, maybe there's obviously pre-processing tricks to play here. Yeah.
You seem to have started your non-private algorithm at a much better place than private.
That's zero.
It's zero.
No, that's a zero. That's zero objective value.
Yes, I mean. Right. After zero iterations, it's all
no. It's this is a zero this way, and it's like it is descending. I'm not plotting the initial. I'm not plotting the initial value. I'm plotting the first published value.
Initial
value. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Sorry. The initialization was randomized. Right. I'm not being super unfair. It's just, but it's batch size. I mean, so you know. It's just like, okay, so you can't just like, you know, it's not like you can do it the day before the homework assignment is due and then expect it to work, right? Okay, and this holds for other data sets as well, and MNIST is apparently particularly bad. So there are lots of knobs to tweak, though, when you implement any of these gradient descent procedures. You have lots of things to play with. You can first off play with the step size. Just choosing the step size 1 over t or whatever and just letting it run is actually usually not going to work well in practice. So it's kind of an art, and so people typically, I was talking to this guy Vivek Worker, and he was like, yeah, so what I do is I just run it for one over two for like 1,000 steps, and then 1/3 for 1,000 steps, and that usually sort of works most of the time, but that's like not science, right? So there's also an issue of the noise level versus multiple passes. I could probably pay like half of my epsilon and do two passes, and maybe that would be better because I have more iterations. There's also something called Polyak averaging, where I average the iterates. That might also be better. In fact, it's often quite much better in practice. But what I'm going to talk about here is mini-batching, which is essentially just processing multiple points at once, which also maybe is not not too surprising. So what do you do with mini-batching? So now I'll just sample B points uniformly at random from the data set, and I'll take average gradients. I'll compute B gradients and then take a step that way. And so with privacy, I'm going to do that, but now I get a B factor reduction in the noise, so maybe it's like everything will be much better. And notice I've just given up on the local privacy model here, because now I can't ask this. I'm not asking for points individually, but it's still sort of continuous observation. So what do we hope here? So if I make one pass, I'm still going to consider taking only one pass through the data. And so now we have a new trade-off. So we could either take very many gradient steps, which are very noisy. So like I'm really drunk and I'm kind of drunkenly stumbling my way through the up to the optimum. Or I could take fewer gradient steps that are less noisy. So I'm a little bit more cautious, but I'd take many fewer steps. And how many fewer? It's like it's 1 over b times the number of steps. So it's like many fewer steps, actually. Okay, so what happens? Oh, look, suddenly it's much, much better. Maybe not surprisingly, and this is only with batch size 5. Yeah, really small batch size takes what looked like garbage before, basically, from anyone who wanted to implement this into to use this into like, yeah, now it's fine. Yeah, it's like actually really good. Maybe I could also have taken epsilon equal to 5. Maybe that would have helped, but. This synthetic one, I think this is actually only 20. I think 20, right? 10 or 20. I can't remember actually for the synthetic.
Somewhere between 10 and 20.
Yeah.
Not super high.
And for MNIST, we've projected down 50, right, or so. And same with, I think, KDD cup. So, yeah, this is lower, not super high dimension. So same thing happens for KDD cup. Also, we only need batch size 5. And for MNIST, which was batch size 10, and now it's like, there you go. They're both started in a good place. They're both very happy, right? And maybe I should have plotted this on a log scale so you could see anything. So moral is mini-batching helps a lot. Small mini-batching helps a lot, right? Okay, good. Okay, what about the best batch size? Now that we know that it helps, so we should now ask harder questions. What's the best batch size? Okay, well, it looks like from the synthetic data experiment, it looks like, oh, I should just keep choosing larger and larger batch size, which seems a little odd to me. Oh, seems to hold in this other data set. This is for step size 1 over t. And also for MNIST. So now the message is, okay, bigger batches are good. In fact, take as large batches as you possibly can subject to your computational constraints, right? And then that seems a bit suspicious. So maybe we should step back and say, okay, what else is going on? But it's not actually true. I mean, it'd hockey stick up at some point. So going back to the synthetic data, so now this is with step size 100 over t. If you change it to 1 over root t, then you're being a bit less aggressive in your steps. And when you're less aggressive in your steps, actually taking very large batch size starts to hurt you. And so the point is that you do get a knee kind of around 5 in this case, also around 5 in KDD cup or 10. You get a similar kind of knee, and you see here is that bigger batches are good for aggressive step sizes, like 1 over t, and then optimal batch size, there is a sort of optimal batch size for more conservative step sizes. And so there's a relationship between these two things, which we don't quite understand theoretically, but clearly is empirically, yeah.
Did you try
adapting the step size?
Yeah, having the batch size change.
No, we didn't try that, but that's another thing that you could do as well. Yeah, it's just there's like a lot of, like I said, there are a lot of knobs, so that might in fact have very good empirical performance for all I know. Like because then you would essentially tune the noise to the step size.
Right. So you might imagine in those first steps having accurate, those first steps where you're traveling far.
Yeah. You want to be more accurate, right? Yeah. And then you can just kind of wiggle around with small step size at the end. Yeah. Okay, so there are many, many, now that I'm at time, I think, there are many, many interesting questions, many. So there's like, how should we set all of these knobs? There's other knobs to choose besides the step size and the batch size. You could try averaging, you could try. The one question is, what gains are there if I don't demand continuous observation? What if I don't have to publish the iterates of my gradient descent algorithm? Then maybe I should be able to do, maybe you should do better. I mean, hopefully you should do better. The question we are motivated in this, the reason we're looking at this is we're motivated by problems that essentially looking at multiple sources of data with different privacy constraints, and therefore you sort of have to process them in some order. The question is, what order should you process them in? There's obviously connections to online gradient learning algorithms, as well as and also algorithms like mirror descent, which is a different way of solving the same problem. So there should be interesting ways of working on that as well. And also, just in general, these kind of stochastic. What about stochastic optimization versions of other algorithms, like the power iteration? Maybe there's a sort of single point version of that could also be benefit from, because those kind of things also appear in a lot of machine learning applications. So thank you, and happy to take any questions. Yeah.
So can you go back to the paper?
Yeah.
So the paper with Prateek and Ravish and this 2011 paper, doesn't that say that if we do not have continuous observation, the stochastic gradient descent will perform exactly in terms of sample complexity as top line?
Yeah, but this is, I'm not actually interested in the sample complexity. I want to know what the, I mean, so sample complexity is fine. A lot of gradient descent procedures, you have two gradient descent procedures and they work, both have like, you know, 1 over t convergence to the optimum, but then one of them will actually turn out to be much better than the other one. So, yeah, it's true. I agree. Yeah, I mean, so being exactly sample complexity optimal is a good thing, but it's sort of not what we're looking at here yet.
I think someone else had a question.
Claire. Oh, currently, I think there's a tighter error convergence rate for the averaging algorithm.
Oh, for polyarc averaging?
Under general losses.
There's a recent archive.
Not all loss functions, not all properties of strong convexity and smoothness have been studied for the last iterate.
Right.
So actually I have a student working on that.
Okay, cool. I'd love to know more. Yeah.
So your algorithms end up touching much less than the whole data set, right? Like on a lot of these experiments,
For MNIST, actually, I think we ended up processing. We're not doing one versus, we're doing one with some digit versus all versus the rest, right? So they're in like the data. So you mean in the plots?
Yeah.
For some of the algorithms, we don't end up touching all of the data. So.
So, you could use that to get to change your epsilons. So say, just the fact that you're.
Oh, I can change my epsilons at every step. Yeah.
No, what I meant is that because you're only working with a subsample of the data, mm-hmm. that sort of amplifies your epsilon. If the total.
Mm-hmm.
You're saying if you're gonna, you know, if the number of iterations and the relative to the number of batches, the size of the batches is such that say you only touch, you know, 5% of your data.
Yeah, it's much more than 5% that we're touching, right? So.
Okay. So yeah. I guess that was my.
Question. Yeah. It's not like. It's not like constant fraction where, you know, epsilon, just some small epsilon greater than zero of the data that we're touching. We're touching, like, you know, more than half often.
Okay. That would buy you a
ton. It might not buy you a ton, but it could buy you, in the very, very large data set setting, it could buy you quite a bit, actually.
Yeah, so in general, if you sample a p fraction, it basically improves epsilon by p.
Sure. Roughly. Well, we could... Yes, because I'm not telling you which data points I'm touching, right?
Right. Yeah.